This is a reading from the poem of the man God by Maria Valtorta, Volume 1, Episode 51. Judas, Thaddeus at Bethsaida to invite Jesus to the wedding at Cana. 17th of October, 1944. I see the kitchen in Peter's house. In addition to Jesus, there are Peter and his wife, James and John. I think they have just finished eating their supper. They are talking, and Jesus takes an interest in fishing. Andrew enters and says, "Master, there is the man here in whose house you are living, together with another man who says he is your cousin." Jesus gets up and goes towards the door, saying, "Let them come in." And when he sees Judas Thaddeus in the light of the oil lamp and of the fireplace, he exclaims, "You, Judas?" "Yes, Jesus." They kiss each other. Judas Thaddeus is a handsome man, in the fullness of his virile manhood. He is tall, although not quite so tall as Jesus, well-built and strong, of a dark brown olive complexion, like Saint Joseph when young, but not sallow. His eyes have something in common with those of Jesus, because they are blue, verging on periwinkle. His brown beard is squarely cut, his hair wavy, but not so curly as Jesus, and is the same hue as his beard. "I have come from Capernaum. I went there by boat, and I have come here in the same boat to gain time. Your mother sends me. She says, 'Susanna is getting married tomorrow. Please come to the wedding. Mary will be there, and also my mother and brothers. All the relatives have been invited. You would be the only one absent, and they ask you to come and make the young couple happy.'" Jesus bows lightly, stretching out his arms, and says, "A wish of my mother is a law for me, but I will come also for Susanna's and our relatives' sake. Only, I am sorry for you," and he looks at Peter and the others. "They are my friends," he explains to his cousin. And then he mentions their names, beginning with Peter's. He then adds, "And this is John," with a special expression that causes Judas Thaddeus to look at him more carefully, while the beloved disciple blushes. He ends the introduction, stating, "My friends, this is Judas, son of Alphaeus, my cousin according to the custom of the world, because he is the son of the brother of my mother's spouse, a very good friend of mine, and a companion both in life and in work. My house is open to you as it is to the master. Sit down." And then addressing Jesus, Peter says, "So, are we no longer going to Jerusalem with you?" "Of course you will come. I will go after the wedding feast. The only difference is that I will not stop at Nazareth any longer." "Quite right, Jesus, because your mother is my guest for a few days. That is what we intend to do. She will also come here after the wedding. It is the man from Capernaum who speaks thus. This is what we will do. I will now go in Judas's boat to Tiberias, and from there to Cana. With the same boat I will come back to Capernaum with my mother, and with you. You will come the day after the next Sabbath, Simon, if you still wish to come, and we will go to Jerusalem for Passover." "Of course I want to come. Nay, I will come on the Sabbath to hear you in the synagogue." "Are you already teaching, Jesus?" asks Thaddeus. "Yes, my cousin." "And you should hear his words. Ah, no one else speaks like him," exclaims Peter. Judas sighs, with his head resting on his hand, his elbow on his knee. He looks at Jesus and sighs. He seems anxious to speak, but does not dare. Jesus encourages him. "What is the matter, Judas? Why do you look at me and sigh?" "Oh, nothing." "No, it must be something. I am no longer the Jesus of whom you were fond, from whom you had no secrets." "Of course you are, and how I miss you, you, the master of your older cousin. Well then, speak." "I wanted to tell you, Jesus. Be careful. You have a mother. She has but you. You want to be a rabbi different from the others, and you know, better than I do, that the powerful classes do not allow anything which may differ from the customary laws they have laid down. I know your way of thinking. It is a holy one, but the world is not holy, and it oppresses saints. Jesus, you know the fate of your cousin, the Baptist. He is in jail, and if he is not yet dead, it is because that evil tetrarch is afraid of the crowds and of the wrath of God, as evil and superstitious, as cruel and lustful. You, what are you going to do? To what fate are you going to expose yourself?" "Judas, you are so familiar with my way of thinking, and that is what you ask me? Are you speaking on your own initiative? No, don't lie. You have been sent, certainly not by my mother, to tell me such things." Judas lowers his head and becomes silent. "Speak, cousin." "My father, and Joseph and Simon with him, you know, for your sake, because they are fond of you and Mary, do not look favorably on what you intend doing. And they would like you to think of your mother. And what do you think?" I, you are drawn in opposite directions by the voices coming from high above and those coming from the world. I am not saying from below, I say from the world. The same applies to James, even more so. But I tell you that above the world there is heaven, and above the interest of the world there is the cause of God. You must change your ways of thinking. When you learn to do that, you will be perfect. But, and your mother? Judas. She is the only one who, according to the way of thinking of the world, should be entitled to recall me to my duty as a son. That is, to my duty to work for her and provide for her material needs, to my duty to assist and comfort her with my presence. But she does not ask for any of these. Since she had me, she knew she would lose me to find me once again in a much wider manner than the small family circle. And since then, she has prepared for herself for that. Her unreserved voluntary donation of herself to God is nothing new. Her mother offered her in the temple bush before she even smiled at life, and, as she told me, the innumerable times she spoke to me of her holy childhood, holding me close to her heart in the long winter evenings or in the clear, starry summer nights, she gave herself to God since the dawn of her life in this world, and she gave herself even more when she had me, that she might be where I am, fulfilling the mission given to me by God. Everybody will abandon me at a certain point, at a certain moment, perhaps only for a few minutes, but everyone will be overcome by cowardice, and you will think that it would have been better for your own safety if you had never known me. But she, who understood and knows, she will always be with me, and you will become mine once again through her. With the power of her unshaken, loving faith, she will draw you to herself and will thus bring you to me. Because I am in my mother, and she is in me, and we are in God. I would like you all to understand that both you who are my relatives according to the world, and you, friends and children, in a supernatural way, neither you nor anyone else know who my mother is. But if you knew, you would not criticize her in your hearts, stating she is not capable of keeping me subject to her, but you would venerate her as the closest friend of God, the mighty woman who can obtain all graces from the heart of the Eternal Father and from her beloved Son. I will certainly come to Cana. I want to make her happy. You will understand better after the wedding. Jesus is majestic and persuasive. Judas gazes at him. He is thinking. He then says, "And I will certainly come with you, with these friends, if you want me, because I feel that what you say is right. Forgive my blindness and my brothers. You are so much holier than we are. I bear no grudge against those who do not know me. I am also without ill feelings towards those who hate me, but I feel sorry for them because of the harm they do themselves. What have you got in that satchel?" "The tunic your mother sent you. It is a big feast tomorrow. She thinks that her Jesus will need it, so that he may not look out of place amongst all the guests. She worked from early morning till late night every day to have it ready for you, but she did not finish the mantle. Its fringes are not yet ready, and she is very sorry about it. Does not matter. I will wear this one, and I will keep that one for Jerusalem. The temple is much more important than a wedding feast. She will be so happy. If you want to be on the way to Cana at dawn, you ought to leave at once. The moon is rising, and it will be a pleasant crossing," says Peter. "Let us go then. Come, John, I am taking you with me. Goodbye, Simon Peter, James, Andrew. I will see you on the Sabbath evening at Capernaum. Goodbye, woman. Peace be with you and your house." Jesus goes out with Judas and John. Peter follows them as far as the lake and helps them cast off, and the vision ends. Jesus says, "When it is time to arrange the work in order, insert the vision of the wedding at Cana here. Put in the date, 16th of January, 1944.